The Times, 2nd of May, 1951. Dr. Ludwig Wittgenstein, who died in his 62nd year on Sunday at Cambridge, was a philosopher with a reputation as an intellectual innovator on the highest level. His earlier and later work formed the points of origin of two schools of philosophy, both of which he himself disowned. Throughout his life, Wittgenstein showed the characteristics of a religious contemplative of the hermit type. Thus he alternated between periods of great prominence in academic life and periods of extreme abnegation and retirement. We are still too close to Wittgenstein to form a just estimate of his work.
Edward said, "Someone's coming to tea who's very, very important to me. You're not to say anything, and just be with us for tea." And so he came, and I watched him, and I poured out tea, and I did the usual thing with the scones. And the only thing, at the very end, he said he'd just come back from America. All the time, he'd only looked at Edward. I was just there pouring the tea. And I then said, "But how lucky to have been to America." And then I began to learn, because he looked at me as only he could look and said, "What do you mean by lucky?" That was my very first encounter.
Mine is the first and only world. I want to report the world as I found it.
The first thing I think I heard about Wittgenstein was that he was something very dangerous. I was forbidden by my supervisor to go to lectures that were influenced by him, so of course those were the ones I did go to. And then I discovered that everybody else thought that he was the best thing that happened by far in 20th century philosophy. What he thought was that previous philosophers had tried to say what couldn't be said, and to that extent they should be honoured. They tried to talk about things that you can't actually talk about at all, Wittgenstein thought, but which were the most important things in life. For example, they tried to talk about the meaning of life, God, how one ought to behave, what it is for things to be beautiful. But if you read Wittgenstein's writings, with very, very few exceptions, you find him saying nothing about what's right and wrong, what's beautiful and what isn't, and why, what kind of religious beliefs ought to be held. And that isn't inadvertence or anything like that. It's because he really did believe fundamentally that everything that mattered most couldn't be said. When one said everything that can be said, one's produced all the propositions of the natural sciences or common sense. Great. But they actually aren't important at all compared to what really is important, and that can't be said, and that is the most fundamental of all his concerns, I think.
Wittgenstein, Ludwig Josef Johann, genius. Born in Vienna, 26th of April, 1889, the youngest of eight children. Three sisters and four brothers, three of whom would commit suicide. Wittgenstein's father, Karl, had once run away to New York to work as a waiter, violinist and barge hand before returning to Vienna to become an iron and steel magnate and one of the richest men in Austria. Wittgenstein's favourite sister was Hermina. 15 years older than Ludwig, Hermina later wrote a short private account of her brother's early life.
In his youth, Ludwig showed great interest in all things technical. By the age of 10, for example, Ludwig was already so familiar with the construction of a sewing machine that he was able to produce a small model of one out of pieces of wood and bits of wire, which actually sewed a few stitches.
The Wittgenstein children were educated at home and followed an eccentric curriculum devised by their father. As a result, Ludwig was unable to gain entry to a Viennese gymnasium. He was sent to a provincial school in Linz and then to the Technical University in Berlin, where he studied aeronautical engineering.
At this time, or shortly after, philosophy, or rather reflection on philosophical problems, suddenly became such an obsession with him, and it took hold of him so completely against his will that that he suffered terribly, feeling torn between conflicting vocations. This was the first of several transformations he was to undergo in his life, and it shook his whole being.
Deeply interested in the foundations of mathematics, Wittgenstein went to Cambridge to seek out Bertrand Russell. Russell was by now recognized throughout Europe as the outstanding mathematical logician of the day.
The 18th of October, 1911. An unknown German appeared, speaking very little English, but refusing to speak German. He turned out to be a man who had learned engineering at Charlottenburg, but during his course had acquired, by himself, a passion for the philosophy of mathematics, and he has now come to Cambridge to hear me. Wittgenstein said to me, "Do you think I'm an absolute idiot?" I said, "Why do you want to know?" He said, "Because if I am, I shall become an aeronaut, but if I'm not, I shall become a philosopher." I said, "My dear fellow, I do not know whether you are an absolute idiot or not. But if you will write me an essay on any philosophical topic that interests you, I will read it and tell you." As soon as I read the first sentence, I became persuaded that he was a man of genius, and assured him that he should on no account become an aeronaut.
Dear Mr. Russell, logic is still in the melting pot, but one thing gets more and more obvious to me. The propositions of logic contain only apparent variables, and whatever may turn out to be the proper explanation of apparent variables, its consequence must be that there are no logical constants. Logic must turn out to be a totally different kind than any other science.
At that stage, which was, I mean, looking back from 70 years on, seems a kind of blissfully innocent stage in the history of philosophy in a way, because things in a certain way were very straightforward then. Russell had just, to his satisfaction, and to other people's probable satisfaction if they'd been able to understand what he was saying, had just, in a monumental book that he wrote with Whitehead, called Principia Mathematica, he just founded mathematics on what he regarded as an absolutely secure basis. That then became, for him and for Wittgenstein, a paradigm of the kind of thing that philosophers should do.
In 1912, I visited Ludwig in Cambridge. He had become friends with Russell, and both of us had been invited to tea in Russell's beautiful college rooms. Suddenly, Russell said to me, "We expect the next big step in philosophy to be taken by your brother." This statement was so extraordinary and incredible to me that for a moment, everything went black.
Dear Russell, we have excellent weather here, such that one does most thinking in the open air. There is nothing more wonderful in the world than the true problems of philosophy. Dear Russell, I'm glad you read the lives of Mozart and Beethoven. These are the actual sons of God. I have thought of the possibility, namely that all our troubles could be overcome by assuming different sorts of relations of signs to things, over and over and over again for the last 8 weeks. But I have come to the conclusion,
dear Russell, that this assumption does not...
I believe that our problems can be traced down to the atomic propositions. This you will see if you try to explain precisely in what way the copula in such a proposition has meaning.
Dear Russell, I have changed my views on atomic complexes. I now think that qualities, relations like love, etc., are all copula. That means I...
Dear Russell, I will leave Vienna on Saturday and will be in Cambridge either on Sunday night or Monday morning. I long very much to see you again. Yours ever, Ludwig Wittgenstein.
Getting to know Wittgenstein was one of the greatest intellectual adventures of my life. He has more passion about philosophy than I have. His avalanches make mine seem mere snowball. He has the pure intellectual passion in the highest degree, and it makes me love him. His disposition is that of an artist, intuitive and moody. He says that every morning he begins his work with hope, and every evening he ends in despair. He used to come and see me every evening at midnight and pace up and down my room like a wild beast for 3 hours in agitated silence. Once I said to him, "Are you thinking about logic or your sins?" "Both," he replied, and continued his pacing.
In the spring of 1912, Wittgenstein had met David Hume Pinsent, who was to become his close friend.
Wittgenstein is reading philosophy up here, but has only just started systematic reading. And he expressed the most naive surprise that all the philosophers he once worshipped in ignorance are after all stupid and dishonest and make disgusting mistakes. He was very communicative and told me lots about himself. That for 9 years, till last Christmas, he suffered from terrific loneliness. That he continually thought of suicide and felt ashamed of never daring to kill himself. We want to settle down in a place where we can be quite alone from tourists for, say, 3 weeks. Upon this, Ludwig is very firm. There we will get some walking and sailing on the fjord, if possible, and do some work. I at law, and Ludwig at logic.
20th September 1913. Dear Russell, Pinsent is an enormous comfort to me here. We've hired a little sailing boat and go about with it on the fjord, or rather, Pinsent is doing all the sailing and I sit in the boat and work. Types are not yet solved, but I have had all sorts of ideas which seem to me very fundamental.
He talked again tonight about his death, that he was not really afraid to die, but yet frightfully worried not to let the few remaining moments of his life be wasted. It all hangs on his absolutely morbid conviction that he's going to die soon. There's no reason that I can see why he should not live yet for a long time. But it's no use trying to dispel that conviction or his worries about it by reason. The conviction and the worry he can't help, for he is mad.
October 1913. Wittgenstein burst in like a whirlwind just back from Norway. He is determined to return there at once to live in complete solitude until he has solved all the problems of logic. I said it would be dark, and he said he hated daylight. I said it would be lonely, and he said he prostituted his mind talking to intelligent people. I said he was mad, and he said God preserve him from sanity. God certainly will. Wittgenstein is more intellectually intimate to me than anyone I have ever met, and yet I shall be thankful to see him go.
Skjolden, 29th October 1913. Dear Russell, this is an ideal place to work in as I hardly meet a soul. Being alone here does me no end of good, and I do not think I could now bear life among people. Inside me, everything is in a state of ferment. The big question now is, how must a system of signs be constituted in order to make every tautology recognizable as such in one and the same way? This is the fundamental question of logic. I am convinced that I shall never publish anything in my lifetime. But after my death, you must see to the publishing of the volume of my journal with the whole story in it. My day passes between logic, whistling, going for walks, and being depressed. I wish to God that I were more intelligent, and everything would finally become clear to me. You heard the Eroica. What did you think of the second movement? Isn't it incredible? It's extraordinary, isn't it, what a huge and infinitely strange science logic is. Neither you nor I knew that, I think, a year and a half ago. Yours ever, Ludwig Wittgenstein. P.S. I'm now building myself a small house here, miles from anyone.
Ludwig went to Norway to work on his book in complete solitude. He built himself a small cabin on a rocky point, jutting out into a fjord, and he lived all alone there in a heightened state of intellectual intensity, which verged on the pathological.
Deep inside me, there's a perpetual seething like the bottom of a geyser. I keep on hoping that things will come to an eruption once and for all so that I can turn into a different person. Perhaps you regard this thinking about myself as a waste of time, but how can I be a logician before I'm a human being? Far the most important thing is to settle accounts with myself.
At the outbreak of war, Wittgenstein returned to Vienna and immediately enlisted as a volunteer in the Austrian army. He was on active service within 10 days.
The war saved my life. I don't know what I'd have done without it. I've lived through dreadful scenes. No sleep for 30 hours. I'm feeling very weak and can see no external help. Now I should have the chance to be a decent human being, for I am standing eye to eye with death.
For the first few months of the war, it was still possible to write to him and to hear from him. But before long, this became impossible. He later told me that once in a village on the Russian front, he chanced upon a bookshop in which there was only one book. This was Tolstoy on the Gospels. He bought it and was much impressed by it. He read it and reread it, and thereafter had it always with him, under fire and at all times.
What do I know about God and the purpose of life? I know that this world exists, that I am placed in it like my eye in its visual field, that something about it is problematic, which we call its meaning, that this meaning does not lie in it, but outside it, that life is my world, that my will penetrates the world, that my will is good or evil, therefore that good and evil are somehow connected with the meaning of the world. The meaning of life, in other words, the meaning of the world, we can call God. Winter is setting in. Once again, no clarity of vision. Yet I am so obviously on the point of solving the most profound problems, so much so that the solution is practically under my nose. The thing is, my mind is simply blind to it just at this moment. I feel that I am at the very gate, but cannot see it clearly enough to be able to open it. This is an extremely remarkable state, which I have never experienced so clearly as at present. Yes. My work has broadened out from the foundations of logic to the nature of the world. A man who is happy has no fear, not even in the face of death. Only a man who lives not in time, but in the present, is happy. For life in the present, there is no death. Death is not an event in life. It is not a fact of the world. Dear gracious lady, today I received your kind letter with the sad news of David's death. David was my first and my only friend. The hours I have spent with him have been the best of my life. Daily have I thought of him and have longed to see him again. God will bless him. If I live to see the end of the war, I will come and see you and we will talk of David. One thing more. I have just finished the philosophical project on which I was already at work in Cambridge. I had always hoped to be able to show it to him sometime, and it will always be connected with him in my mind. I will dedicate the book to David's memory. Dear Russell, I am a prisoner of war in Italy since November and hope I may communicate with you after a 3 years interruption.
I've written a book called Logisch-Philosophische Abhandlung, containing all my work of the last 6 years. I believe I've solved our problems, finally. This may sound arrogant, but I can't help believing it. I've got the manuscript here with me. I wish I could copy it out for you, but it's pretty long and I would have no safe way of sending it to you. In fact, you would not understand it without a previous explanation, as is written in quite short remarks. This, of course, means that nobody will understand it, although I believe it's all as clear as crystal. I will publish it as soon as I get home.
Wittgenstein was finally released in August 1919, but it would be another 2 years before his book would find a publisher. Meanwhile, Wittgenstein and Russell met in Holland to discuss the book.
I feel sure it is a really great book, though I do not feel it is right. I told him I could not refute it, and that I was sure it was either all right or all wrong, but it would take me many years to decide this. This, of course, didn't satisfy him, but I couldn't say more.
This book will perhaps only be understood by those who have themselves already thought the thoughts which are expressed in it, or similar thoughts. It is therefore not a textbook. Its object would be attained if there were one person who read it with understanding and to whom it afforded pleasure. The book deals with the problems of philosophy and shows, as I believe, that the method of formulating these problems rests on the misunderstanding of the logic of our language. Its whole meaning could be summed up in the following words: what can be said at all can be said clearly. And what we cannot talk about, we must pass over in silence.
It's incredibly difficult. He says, whatever can be said clearly. Well, I mean, one has to subscribe to a particular definition of clear if one's going to say that the Tractatus is clear. It's for one thing, very technical. It makes use of the most advanced logical investigations of Russell, so that, I mean, that in itself makes it rather difficult, but the way in which Wittgenstein puts it is gnomic, to say the least. And even and a few years later, when the book was being translated into English, and the translator asked Wittgenstein what he meant by various things in German, Wittgenstein said he himself had forgotten. And or didn't understand, or couldn't imagine how he could have been. I mean, the kind of thing that he often said, he couldn't imagine how he could have been such a fool as to say this, that, or the other. So he can't have meant what it looked as if he meant. I mean, I wouldn't recommend that anybody should go to the Tractatus for illumination or for anything except possibly the odd bit of inspirational reading on the last three or four pages, which deal with ethics and aesthetics. The rest of the book is totally obscure and has generated a most enormous amount of commentary by people trying to understand it.
We feel that even if all possible scientific questions be answered, the problems of life have still not been touched at all. Of course, there is then no question left, and just this is the answer.
Wittgenstein's fundamental interest in philosophy the whole of his life was in the relationship between language and the world. There, I mean, we take it that there's a world out there independent of us, and we've evolved a language for describing it. And in the Tractatus, Wittgenstein makes a very heroic and extremely austere attempt, which is related to Russell's investigations in the philosophy of mathematics, to present an account of how language does portray the world, and it results in something called the picture theory of meaning. He says that propositions about the world, for example, to take the most banal case possible, the cat is on the mat, are that propositions like that are pictures of reality, and that anything that's meaningful, anything that can be sensibly stated, bears the same kind of relationship to the world as the cat is on the mat. And anything that doesn't bear that kind of relationship to the world isn't meaningful. Now, philosophical propositions don't bear that kind of relationship to the world. The relationship between the cat is on the mat and the fact that there is a cat sitting on a mat is not reduplicated in philosophy in the way that philosophers talk about such subjects and the world In other words, philosophy, talking philosophy, is bound to be a senseless procedure. And Wittgenstein says famously at the end of the Tractatus that anybody who's understood what he said in the Tractatus will realise that they've climbed up a ladder which they've got to throw away. They'll realise that everything he said is nonsense.
He must, so to speak, throw away the ladder after he has climbed up on it. He must surmount these propositions. Then he sees the world rightly. Whereof one cannot speak, thereof one must be silent.
With the Tractatus, Wittgenstein believed he had finally solved all the outstanding problems of philosophy, and it would be several years before he was able to detect grave errors in his thinking. Meanwhile, he had been profoundly influenced by the war and by his reading of Tolstoy and the Gospels. He gave away all his money to his sisters and turned his back on the world. At a monastery north of Vienna, he took up a job as assistant gardener.
My inner life is nothing to write home about. How things will go for me, how I'll endure life, God only knows. Every day I think of poor Pinsent. He took half my life away with him. The devil will take the other half.
Wittgenstein became for a time very religious. In order to make a living, he became an elementary schoolmaster in a country village called Trattenbach. He would write to me saying, "The people of Trattenbach are very wicked." I would say, "Yes, all men are very wicked." He would then reply, "True, but the men of Trattenbach are more wicked than the men of other places." My logical sense revolted against any such proposition. But he had some justification for his opinion. The peasants refused to supply him with milk because he taught their children sums that were not about money.
Wittgenstein Schüler, einer der wenigen, die noch leben. Also zwei sind wir noch, Männer in der Gemeinde, die leben und die echt Wittgenstein Schüler waren. Emmerich, was machen wir heute Nachmittag? Da sagt der Herr Lehrer, machen wir wieder einen Spaziergang oder so. Und sind wir heute ins Gelände hinausgegangen. Er hat immer was Interessantes gesehen. Draußen im Freien, im Gottesfreien, da war er glücklich. Im Klassenzimmer, da war er grantig. Ja, eher grantig.
In 1923, the Cambridge mathematical prodigy Frank Plumpton Ramsey went to Lower Austria to seek out Wittgenstein and discuss the Tractatus.
We really live in a great time for thinking, with Einstein, Freud and Wittgenstein all alive, and all in Germany or Austria, those foes of civilization. Wittgenstein is very poor, at least he lives very economically. He has one tiny room, whitewashed, containing a bed, washstand, small table and one hard chair, and that's all there's room for. He seems to live a very dreary life, having only one friend here, and being regarded by most of his colleagues as a little mad. He is prepared to give 4 or 5 hours a day to explaining his book. I have had 2 days and got through 7 out of 80 pages. When the book is done, I shall try to pump him for ideas for its further development, which I shall attempt. Wittgenstein says he himself will do nothing more, not because he's bored, but because his mind is no longer flexible. He says no one can do more than 5 or 10 years' work at philosophy, and his book took 7. I ought to have done something positive with my life. To have become a star in the sky. Instead, I remain stuck on Earth and I'm now gradually fading out.
By 1926, difficulties with local parents and the authorities had made things impossible for Wittgenstein, and he left school teaching for good. In Vienna, his sister Margareta was having a new house designed by the architect Paul Engelmann. Wittgenstein joined Engelmann on the project, but soon he took it over completely.
Ludwig designed every window and door, every window lock and radiator, with as much care and attention to detail as if they were precision instruments, and on a most elegant scale. With his uncompromising energy, he ensured that everything was carried out with the same meticulous care. I can still hear the locksmith asking him, in connection with a keyhole, "Tell me, Herr Engineer, does a millimeter here or there really matter so much to you?" Ludwig replied with such a loud, forceful, "Yes," that the man almost jumped with fright. The same attention was devoted to the most inconspicuous detail as to the main features, for everything was important. Nothing was unimportant, except time and money. The completion of the house probably also marked the end of another stage in Ludwig's development, and he turned again to philosophy. If I remember correctly, he first worked in Norway on a new piece of philosophical writing, and then went to Cambridge again. There he was made Professor of Philosophy at Trinity College.
I remember Mr. Wittgenstein, I think he's Dr. Wittgenstein, but I didn't know that. He was in lodgings very close to my business here. One day he did come into my shop with a broken key. Could I help him? He'd broken the key in a lock. So I said, "Well, yeah, I'll help. Where is it?" And so he said, "Well, it's at my rooms in the college." I didn't know he was in the college at the time. But anyway, we just walked off down to the back of Trinity College, up some stairs, and there he'd got a big trunk, rather like a trunk you'd have on the back of a motor car in those days, or if you were going on a sea voyage, you see. And there was a pipe of a key broken in the lock. Well, I fiddled with it and couldn't get it out, and so I then had the idea that gravity would help. So I asked Mr. Wittgenstein for two chairs, which he got, place where I wanted them. I picked the trunk up and put it on the chairs with the lock facing downwards. And then I got underneath and twiddled with it with a hairpin or something until the broken piece fell out. And then I'd got a bundle of keys in my pocket and I tried one or two until one opened it. He was very impressed with that.
That must be the end of a theme which I cannot place. It came into my head today as I was thinking about my philosophical work and saying to myself, "I destroy, I destroy, I destroy."
What he's destroying is houses of cards, as he puts it in the investigations, because that's what philosophical theories are, houses of cards, and they've got to be knocked down. One doesn't necessarily do it with the gleeful relish. I mean, it's rather sad that that impressive intellectual monuments should turn out to need to be knocked down, but they do.
One of the houses of cards was Wittgenstein's own Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus.
Since beginning to occupy myself with philosophy again, I have been forced to recognize grave mistakes in what I wrote in that first book. I was helped to realize these mistakes, to a degree which I myself am hardly able to estimate, by the criticism which my ideas encountered from Frank Ramsey, with whom I discussed them in innumerable conversations during the last 2 years of his life.
Wittgenstein now saw that the relationship between language and the world was far more untidy, far more complex than he had previously imagined. The real task of the philosopher was to dissect out the heart of a problem by close analysis of the language in which it was posed, and by so doing, dissolve it. And this was what Wittgenstein attempted to do in his famous Cambridge lectures.
We are engaged in a struggle with language. Philosophy is a struggle against the bewitchment of our intelligence by means of language.
I remember climbing up those stone steps to his room, and I suppose there were about 20 people in the room. And when 5 o'clock struck, Wittgenstein sprang to his feet, and then he started telling people what sort of thing he was going to do. He wasn't going to teach them anything, he said, like geography or science, imparting any knowledge to them. What he was going to do was only useful to people who were suffering from some form of mental cramp. And he described his activity as that of a masseur, easing that cramp. If you hadn't got it, he wasn't going to be any use to you.
What is the meaning of a word? Let us attack this question by asking first, what is an explanation of the meaning of a word? What does the explanation of a word look like? The questions, the way this question is length, helps us, what is meaning, what is the number one, etc., produce in us a mental cramp. We feel that we can't point to anything in reply to them, and yet ought to point to something. We are up against one of the great sources of philosophical bewilderment. The expression, explanation of meaning, will teach you something about the grammar of the word meaning, and will cure you of the temptation to look about you for some object which you might call the meaning.
He got worked up to some particular point, spinning out thoughts, and if he were really caught out, he would curse himself. Would you like me to say what sort of thing he said? Oh, damn my bloody soul, he'd say. And then, if nothing occurred to him to get him out of that state of mind, he would suddenly turn to people, help me, someone. And if you were able to say something which was helpful, he would ask you to go on. He would. His gesture was one like that. He would say, go on. But if he didn't like it, it just wasn't going to lead anywhere. He would motion like that with his arm. And of course, you felt pretty awful then. I suppose most people who put something forward like that were rather taken aback. But you got used to it after a while. And sometimes he encouraged you and sometimes he didn't.
Wittgenstein very much needed friends. He always liked a friend to go to the movies with him after his classes. He insisted on sitting in the front row, the very front row of the cinema, as close to the screen as possible, so that there would be nothing in his field of vision except this screen. And the aim of that was to try to free his mind of the philosophical questions that tormented him.
Dear Malcolm, your detective mags are wonderful. How people can read mind if they could read Street and Smith beats me. If philosophy has anything to do with wisdom, there's certainly not a grain of that in mind, and quite often a grain in detective stories.
With the rise of Hitler and the Austrian Anschluss of 1938, Wittgenstein had been advised not to return to Vienna and had taken British nationality.
My flat in Vienna has been destroyed by a bomb, and it is likely that the Hochreit, where we stored most of our works of art for safety, has also been destroyed. For the area saw some of the Hest fighting, and the houses at the Hochreit have been turned into a German headquarters. Even if my fears proved to be justified, it would no longer mean anything, for all things have lost their value in this terrible time of war, and one can only be concerned about the fate of mankind.
Strangely, Wittgenstein himself had little to say about events in Europe. Early in the war, he left Cambridge to work as a porter at Guy's Hospital and later did medical research in Newcastle.
Dear Malcolm, I very rarely come to Cambridge now, about once every 3 months. I'm supposed, of course, to come back there as a professor after the war, but I must say I can't quite imagine how I'll be able to do it. I wonder if I shall ever be able to teach philosophy again regularly. I rather think I shan't be able to.
Wittgenstein was pathologically concerned with the kind of purity of thought. One must be as absolutely cleanly scrubbed intellectually as possible, and there are so many ways of getting dirty intellectually, and he saw them, he thought, particularly powerfully in Cambridge, which is why he hated coming back to Cambridge and felt particularly depressed always as he walked down Station Road into Cambridge, because he thought, you know, here I am coming back to all this intellectual squalor, i.e. characters talking about intellectual problems and not really caring about them, making a lot of fuss, creating a lot of mental dirt, that's what it comes to, and he found it very difficult under those circumstances to remain clean in the way that he wanted to.
The thoughts which I publish in what follows are the precipitate of philosophical investigations which have occupied me for the last 16 years. They concern many subjects: the concepts of meaning, of understanding, of a proposition, of logic, the foundations of mathematics, states of consciousness, and other things. I make them public with doubtful feelings. It is not impossible that it should fall to the lot of this work in its poverty and in the darkness of this time to bring light into one brain or another, but of course it is not likely. I should not like my writing to spare other people the trouble of thinking, but if possible to stimulate someone to thoughts of his own. I should have liked to produce a good book. This has not come about, but the time is past in which I could improve it.
I have not found in Wittgenstein's philosophical investigations anything that seemed to me interesting, and I do not understand why a whole school finds important wisdom in its pages. The later Wittgenstein seems to have grown tired of serious thinking and to have invented a doctrine which would make such an activity unnecessary.
Well, Russell and Wittgenstein, I mean, like many old friends, came to dislike one another heartily, I think. I mean, that they'd started in... Well, sorry, Wittgenstein, when he came to Cambridge, was very impressed by Russell. Russell was very impressed by Wittgenstein. Getting to know Wittgenstein, he said, was the most exciting intellectual experience of my life. And he paid very elaborate tribute to Wittgenstein and did an enormous amount for Wittgenstein financially and in all kinds of other ways. But then, partly, I think, out of sheer pique at the fact that he, Russell, had been the philosopher, and he lived long enough. I mean, he was a Struldbrugian character, so he lived forever, more or less, as you know. He lived long enough to see his influence completely replaced by Wittgenstein's, which, since he was a very vain person, upset him a lot. But, I mean, Russell, I think, should have known better, really. He should have seen, if he'd read the philosophical investigations with the intensity that they required, that Wittgenstein was trying to do something extremely new in philosophy. He didn't see that at all. He just thought that Wittgenstein was saying, forget all this nonsense about knowledge and certainty and all that stuff. What we all believe to start with is fine, and that's all there is to it. Well, that was Wittgenstein's conclusion, but what's interesting is the elaborate way in which he comes round it, which Russell seems to have either not understood or not taken any notice of.
The doctors have now made their diagnosis. I have cancer of the prostate. But this sounds, in a way, much worse than it is, for there is a drug, actually some hormones, which I'm told can alleviate the symptoms of the disease so that I can live on for years. The doctor even tells me that I may be able to work again, but I can't imagine that. I was in no way shocked when I heard that I had cancer, but I was when I heard that one could do something about it, because I had no wish to live on. I couldn't have my wish. I believe that as long as I live, and as often as the state of my mind permits it, I will think about philosophical problems and try to write about them. I also believe that much of what I wrote in the past 15 or 20 years may be of interest to people when it's published. But it is nevertheless perfectly possible that all I'm going to produce will be flat, uninspired, and uninteresting.
During the final stages of his illness, Wittgenstein was unwilling to go into hospital. He went back to Cambridge to stay with Dr. Edward Bevan and his wife, Joan.
In a house like this, with lots of people coming and going, he'd walk into the house. I wouldn't stop and say, "This is Wittgenstein." I never introduced him. He just walked barge past and went upstairs. And I never had to explain that was Wittgenstein, because I didn't. And I didn't have to explain there was someone. But he'd no more turn around and shake hands with anyone or anything like that. Oh, no, that wasn't his. He seemed oblivious as though he was walking through us. And we never had meals. Only once we had meals together, when some Americans came. But normally he sat at breakfast facing a window, not speaking to anyone. And there'd be people, my children, coming in and out. But we never spoke to him. He's just a man in the corner.
76 Stories Way, Cambridge, 16th April 1951. Dear Malcolm, an extraordinary thing has happened to me. About a month ago, I suddenly found myself in the right frame of mind for doing philosophy. I had been absolutely certain that I'd never be able to do it. It's the first time after more than 2 years that the curtain in my brain has gone up. Of course, I've only worked for about 5 weeks, and it may all be over by tomorrow, but it bucks me up a lot now. Give my love to everybody. Affectionately, Ludwig.
He was suddenly taken very ill. And that night, the night when he became unconscious, I went up and said, "I promised we won't leave you alone," so I put a camp bed on beside him. And then he settled down, and then suddenly he said, "Tell them I've had a wonderful life."
What is your aim in philosophy? To show the fly the way out of the fly bottle. Are you a bad philosopher, then, if what you write is hard to understand? If you were better, you would make what is difficult easy to understand. But who says that's possible?